On the back of last week, yes? The Spirit of God is seriously in this place, yes or no?
Yes. I'm sending you a fire. You are being purified so that you can handle it. It's one thing to have a revival. It's one thing to have a pouring out of the Spirit if we're not consecrated. If we've not been purified in the fires of God in our one-to-one relationship. Because it won't last. So we've got to understand this, yeah? It's a bit deep today. I mean, most weeks it's deep, but this, anyway, let me just talk about this before we go into the world. History has shown we can't earn anything in relation to God. We can't. We're saved by grace. Revival happens by grace. But to sustain it, to handle it correctly, because you are playing, in effect, you are being chosen by God to handle a revival, to carry the Spirit, so that when it manifests, you know how to move with it correctly. So I am saying, be prepared in your heart for a purifying process to take place. And that may be painful. That may be some seriously letting go of some things in the past and embracing the moment. We all make mistakes. That's not what this is about. This is about purity and relationship with God. That's what this is about. Despise not the chastening of the Lord. And this is what will happen. Depth, superficiality will be broken off. Triviality will be broken off. And one will find oneself craving and craving unto God, to be used by God. And what else will happen on the back of that? There will be a weaning off the world, because you are starting to drink and taste of the pure pleasure of God, the ecstasy of God. So therefore, there will be a shift in what has been delightful. I'm not saying it's wrong, it's just not satisfying anymore. And because of that becomes not satisfying, therefore one gets purified off that stuff and starts to come into deeper levels of consecration, deeper levels of purification within one's spirit. So what one, this is where it talks about being transformed by the Spirit of God. It's not done in a punishment way. It's not done in that way. It's done in a way because the power of God is transforming you. And therefore, with the power of God transforming you by grace, by mercy, and by you responding Those things fade away, bit by bit, bit by bit. And this is where, you know, sometimes we have a problem. You know, God, the Catholic Church, the Catholic, morality. But there's no power in that if you're just dictating morality. The transformation comes by the power of the Spirit. For if you put to death, if you put to death the things of the flesh by the Spirit, that's how you get transformed. That's how you be transformed, by the power of the Spirit of God in you. Because you have tasted, because you are fellowshipping, and therefore you prioritize that, and therefore it breaks away things. And internally, you get transformed. Does this make sense to you? So be prepared. Be prepared for some brokenness. Be prepared for some letting go. But understand, it will never be in your strength. It will be in the power of the Holy Spirit by you saying, I want to be weaned off these things. I want to grow. I want to be transformed. I want to be more purified by the Spirit of God so that I can handle and flow and be more useful unto God. Amen? Let me tell you one of the ways that you can do this. If we turn our Bibles, please. If we turn our Bibles to Psalm 37. I'll read through it and then there's three key verses that I want us to look at. Delight, the title of the sermon, delight yourself in the Lord. Psalm 37, 1 to 11. Fret not yourself because of evildoers. Do not be envious of wrongdoers, for they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. I'm just going to touch on the first one. Fret not yourself because of evildoers. Do not be envious of wrongdoers. Now, one way you could look at this is this. How often do we compare ourselves with our peers? Well, that's not going on with me. Or I haven't advanced that far. Or I wish I had that. Or I wish I had this. You understand? Now, I'm not saying they're evildoers for that, but I'm trying to get across a principle. How often do we pray, well, I should be further on down the road than this, or something else should be happening here. Do you understand me? You're a child of God. They may not be a child of God. If you are born again, you're a child of God. How much does the world continue to just bombard us with images unless we decide to cut them off? Well, this needs to happen, and that needs to happen, and this should be going on, and that should be going on. Do you understand me? For they will soon fade like grass and wither like the green herb. Verse 3. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and befriend faithfulness. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desired the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in Him. And He will act. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the new noonday. That's your righteousness in Christ. Be still before the Lord. Wait patiently for Him. Fret not yourself over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil devices. Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not yourselves. It tends only to evil. For the evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall inherit the land. In just a while the wicked will be no more. Though you look carefully at his place, he will not be there. But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant peace. There is something called the decretive will of God. The decretive will of God talks about God being a God of decrees. He decrees something. This universe is in existence in the very form it is because God decreed it that way. Even with all the nonsense going on. So there's something called the decretive will of God. There is something called the prescriptive will of God. And there is something called the permissible will of God. I'm going to touch on the prescriptive will and the permissive will. An example of the permissive will is this. The permissive will of God. That terrorists can blow up people. That paedophilia activity, that pornography, robbing, cheating, stealing, corruption. That's known as the permissible will. God is not for that, but he allows that. Because there will come a time when everything gets judged on the highest level by the judge of the universe. So you can get away with stuff. Humanity gets away with doing wickedness, but there will come a time when the judge judges. And it will be a terrible day of judgment for the wicked. Do you understand? But now there is the prescription. And the prescriptive will of God is where God says to us clearly in the Bible, he is prescribing a way for you to do something. I am prescribing that you delight yourself in me. I prescribe that you turn the other cheek. Now you don't have to do that because you don't. But this is what is being prescribed. You go to the pharmacy, I need such and such medicine, the doctor said, the pharmacy makes it and prescribes it, gives it to you. In relation to help you be purified by God, this is God giving a prescription to you to help you. Trust in the Lord and do good. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. This is a psalm of David. David had many reasons not to to delight himself. Many things happened in David's life where he could have not delighted in God, i.e. when his own flesh and blood rose up against him and tried to take the kingdom, when Saul was continually chasing him, when his men at one time turned around and said, let's kill him, because they thought he made a mistake. If you look at the Hebrew for this word delight, it's delighting in something that you find exquisitely luxurious and beautiful. When they give you your engagement ring, Iris, did you cry in sadness?
No.
Were you delighted?
I was.
Somebody turns up and gives you something that you personally put value on. Does it not bring delight? You went to see your father yesterday in London, who I haven't seen for many years. Was he delighted? Delight yourselves in the Lord. How many of us have tasted God? Do we think it's the highest delight in our life or not? We think that.
Yes.
Okay. Can we go a little bit up and down sometimes?
Yes.
We can. But will you take on this prescription? Because even with the up and the down, this is what the Lord is saying to us. Continue to delight yourself in me, and I will give you the desires of your heart. Now, how many times previously, because we're all growing and we're all in different places in the Lord, and that's good, but how many times in the past have we desired something that we knew wasn't really good, but we wanted it? Yes or no?
Yeah.
I've got to keep saying no to these I've got to keep, because he's right by my house, yes? I've got to keep saying no to the double burger big meal at McDonald's, man.
Yes.
I made it 4 times this week. I've got to say no. I've got to say no. It's like a 2-minute walk and it's just easy. I reckon he put something extra special in those cheeseburgers, man, and get you. That's on a trivial level. But it's a real level. I've got to stop it. But how many times have we done something which you know could have a lot more negative consequence if one pursues that? Why do you think God would say the word delight? Is it just like, you know, a servile delight in me type of thing? Why do you think he would say that?
It's a great recompense, it's a great reward, great benefits.
Well, obviously our God is a very confident God of who he is. And he knows who he is. And he realizes there's nothing higher ultimately you can delight in. And because I understand your hearts, and I understand that we can be fickle, and he understands all that about us, but he is saying to you, if you will delight, by delighting on me, and this is in relation to the prophetic thing that came first, about a purifying, your heart, by default, by the power of the Spirit of God, will change your heart into things that are worthy to be desired. Do you understand what I'm saying? If you're a recovering alcoholic, the last thing that you want to be offered really is alcohol. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because you're probably still tied up on that. There's still maybe some hooks in there. And therefore, whatever things we are carrying, which God wants to purify us in, and this is where, you know, we're not talking an aesthetic lifestyle whereby we become monks for 20 odd years. Do you understand me? That's hard. That's harsh. Well, God is saying, delight yourself in me. Praise in me. Come to me. Glorify in me. Speak unto me. Identify with what I am. So when this was originally put out in the Hebrew, delight, it was as if somebody was giving you the greatest, most luxurious luxury possible. Exquisitely beautiful. That's why you were delighting. Because it was something just so wonderful that you, by default, delighted. So with this scripture, by doing that delighting regularly, our hearts, by default, get purified. They get turned away from lesser things unto greater things. And as that goes on more and more and more and more, God gives you the desires of your heart. What do you think by that process, over time, what do you think will be the love sum, the whole desire of your heart? He's not stupid, is he?
No.
He's pretty clever, isn't he?
Very smart.
And he knows how to do it. But don't forget, it's being prescribed. Will you take the prescription?
Will you not take the prescription?
So over time, by this delighting, by this purification, by encountering, by knowing him, coming in deeper, as you have worked it out, your heart's desire will be for him. So as our hearts come more, as our hearts desire him more and more and more, what do you think he may do with us?
More and more and more.
Any ideas? Sorry? Does it not say that in one house there are two types of vessels? Some for ignoble use, menial use, and some for really good use, for noble use. God has a plan for every single one of us. You know this. I know this. But my point is this. That using will come about by you being purified and crying out to God. Remember 2 weeks ago? Not my will, but your will be done. That's what will happen. What took someone like the Apostle Paul or Mary Magdalene? Mary had chances are prostitutes, seven spirits within her. And what took someone like the Apostle Paul to be transformed so radically by God to do what they did? Now, I'm not saying we're all Apostle Pauls. I'm not saying we're all Mary Magdalene. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is this. I'm sending a fire. So let's bring it into contemporary terms. I'm sending my Holy Spirit fire. You are being purified so that you can handle that. So that you can handle what God is going to do when he releases more and more of his fire. That's what I'm trying to say. So maybe issues of pride, got to be dealt with. Maybe issues of lust, got to be dealt with. Maybe issues of fear, got to be dealt with. Maybe issues of covetousness and greed, got to be dealt with. Maybe issues of intimidation, got to be dealt with. But look at the way he prescribes it. By delighting. By delighting. By delighting. Verse 7. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourselves over the one who prospers in his way, over the one who carries out evil devices. We all see the world. We all see bad news, and sometimes that shocks us. And it's right on one level that it does shock us. But please understand this in relation to the God of decree. The decretive will of God. That evil could not be happening unless God allowed it to happen. Not God doing it, but God allowed it. So as we keep hearing more and more wicked stories, depths of new depravity coming forth, because it's happening, we see it. The news that we get now from when I was a kid to what's happening now, it's in a different level. But don't let this completely rock you. Understand that God is sovereign. He's over it. And there will come a time when everything is put to rights. Everything will be dealt with in a higher level of justice than whatever we could ever, ever, ever imagine. Okay? But don't let it discourage your faith. Don't let it, how can that go on, God? Why are you allowing that to go on? Well, God is sovereign, he knows what he's doing, he knew what he was getting before he set up the universe, before we even walked on the planet. So don't forget the permissible. It's not permanently permissible. There comes a time when it's the day of the Lord of judgment. Don't forget, we've been saved from the wrath of God to come. Don't forget, when you see depths of depravity, depths of pain that other people are causing, don't forget that there's darkness and there's outer darkness. So when God comes to judge, he is going to put it absolutely right. You understand me? I'm saying to you, be still before the Lord. Wait patiently for him. Wait patiently. That patiently is not passively. It is an active patience. It is a patience of expectation, but it's a patience that's under control. By the delighting, the heart gets more purified. What is one of the fruits of the Spirit of God? Patience for at the appointed time, because you're walking with him. You know you're walking with him. You know that you are seeking him. You know that you are delighting in him. You know to the best of your ability, You are honoring him. To the best of your ability, you are seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You are saying, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. But sometimes you just got to wait. You've got to be patient. You've got to be patient. You understand me? You've got to be patient. Be still before the Lord. Wait patiently for him. Fret not yourselves over the one who prospers in his way. What do you think God is saying there? In effect, what he's dealing with there is, be not covetous of what's going on with somebody else. Because what's going on with them is going on with them. What is going on with you is going on with you. And again, if you tick those boxes to the best of your ability, you're trying to honor without getting into striving, it's a waiting game sometimes. It's a game, it's not a game, but you've just got to be patient before him. It's a bit of a cliche, but it's true. And how long, which nobody really sees after a building is built, what do you think takes the time? Nobody talks about foundations. Oh, look at that building. Isn't it beautiful? Who thinks of the foundations once it's up? Oh, yeah, can we see the foundation, please? No, you can't, it's covered up. What do you want to look at that for anyway? You want to look at this. What do you imagine if the foundation's wrong? And the building stands up for a period of time and it was a stunning building, but because the foundation was wrong, what are they going to remember? They're going to remember the beauty, which they might, but all they're going to remember, oh, that was the building that was beautiful, but they got the foundations wrong and it collapsed. I'm encouraging you. The foundations, which nobody really sees, which nobody's really interested in, where a lot of work is done, has got to be solid. Because once they are solid and they are put in place, the building up is pretty straightforward. Do you understand? Just next door to this building, you maybe just want to have a look at it for, you know what I mean? The visual set. They are digging the foundations. Now you remember how deep those foundations were, and then over time, look at the building. So let this stay within you. If those foundations are not correct, it's out of line. And that's why, what is Jesus known as? What is one of the metaphors they say to Jesus? Yes, but the cornerstone. The cornerstone is where that cornerstone was in place and every other stone had to be in line with that cornerstone. If the cornerstone was off place, the whole building had a problem. The Bible says he is the cornerstone. So from the cornerstone, every other part of the building going out comes from there. Our God is saying to us, delight yourself in the cornerstone. Delight yourself within me. Because of you delighting yourself within me, I will purify you. I will get rid of things. I am able then to put in a deeper foundation so that you can be used by me and for my glory, whereby you will end up having the most satisfying, most purposeful life that you can imagine. I am not saying, is there going to be pain? No, I'm not saying that. Am I not saying that there'll be times where you might pull your hair out? No, I'm pulling your hair out. No, I am not saying that. Am I saying there might be times when you're literally broken before the floor because you are suffering? No, I'm not saying that. All those things can go with that. So I want to get that right. All those things can go with what I've just said there. Verse 11. But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant peace. But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant peace. I've touched on this once before, but I'm just going to say it again. Have we not received, does the Bible not say that we have received an inheritance in God? Well, that's for me, and I'm not going to get off on that particular end, but that for me is, we're just going to inherit a lot. a lot, okay? I mean, not just planet Earth, we're talking the universe. Yeah. Right? I mean, that's my inheritance. Mm-hmm. Jesus is my brother. We share the Father. The Bible says I'm an inheritor. So therefore, why am I getting caught up if I want to drive to Lincoln's and say it's Ben's when it's just a matter of time when I get a star in the universe? Do you understand what I'm trying to say? I mean, truly, this is the point, you see. But we will never get rid of that mindset unless we have tasted of something better. That's the point, you see. If I haven't tasted of something better, if I don't know of something better, well then that's my glass ceiling, isn't it? Going for the mistakes or having the yacht traveling the world. I mean, that's my ceiling, isn't it? But by tasting of Christ, that ceiling's off. Amen? But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in the abundant peace. This word peace is the Hebrew word shalom. Now that's not, that peace is, really get this, because this is where you will know how much shalom is going off in your life or not. The Jews today will greet each other, shalom. Shalom is speaking about a complete, okay, let's put it into Latin. Complete compos mentis. Completely sound. Completely whole. Completely at peace. I am well. It is well with me. Even though I might be struggling paying a bill. Even though I might be going through some situation which ideally I don't want to go in, but internally, my person, my being, I am well. I am well. Things are sound. Things are primarily good with me. Even though I've still got these external stuff going on out there, happening. But me, as a person, I am well. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. And that has nothing to do the way that they mean it is to do with externalities of what you're facing. I'm going to give you a story. There were four missionaries. Forgive me, I don't know if you've heard of it. There were four missionaries. True story. Four South Korean missionary, four South Korean missionaries operating in Afghanistan. Taliban country. They get caught. They're put into prison. They're in the prison cell. They come in. They take one, they execute it. Their government, South Korean government,
starts, you know, they want to do stuff, they're trying to help them.
So there's four of them, one's been executed. There's three left in the cell. Cut a long story short, the government was able to broker a deal to release the other three. So they're back now in Korea, South Korea. They're being interviewed. One of them, the guys in the suit, so how did you, how about all that experience that you experienced over there? And one guy turned around and said this, I wish I was back in that cell. Well, you're back. Your mate just got executed, and for all you know, you could have been the next one. What do you mean you wish you were back in that cell? You don't know the level of peace we experienced in that cell. You don't know how much the presence of God we tasted in that cell. When we had what we had happen to us, to the glory of God, joy came forth. I didn't know joy was going to come forth. I could have absolutely gone, I don't know. But that's what came forth. So my point is this. Regardless of the externals, and this is where you know, this is where you know how much shalom, how much peace is operating in you. And if it's not operating in you, the chances are it's because of this. Not all the time, but I'm saying this as an example. If you're not meeting regularly, if you're not delighting regularly, the flesh comes up. But if you're in a place where you are delighted, you are meeting, the Holy Spirit is feeding you, you're going on for the Lord, you will have that peace manifest. And if it's not, you need to check yourself and just check what's going on. And I tell you this, it will come down to about four or five things. A, you're not having regular communion. B, you're not studying your word. C, you are studying your word, but you're not applying your word. D, the enemy is trying to attack and you don't know how to play it because you're not exercising the word of God. The last one will be, sometimes the Lord is just doing a shift with you. He's just shifting you into a new place. And this is what I'm trying to tell you today. You may feel some easiness because God is about to take you into another level of purification. And sometimes that is unsettling. Because what is going on, your flesh is being broken. It's being broken. And sometimes that's not nice. But with the brokenness, the peace is there. Do we understand what I've just said? We will call it a day. Delight yourselves in the Lord, for He shall give you the desires of your heart. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That's it.